Good afternoon. We are members of the 50th Rifle Division as part of Military History Club Istochnik, and we're here today to talk about some of the material and social conditions of the Red Army of World War II, the decisive player in the Second World War. So to that end, I have some item to show you. Please hand me the SVT. So what we have here is everybody's favorite part to talk about is above weaponry. Now this is the SVT-40, a self-loading rifle that was developed by the Red Army shortly before World War II. The plan was to re-equip the entire army with this new weapon that would have been much better than the usual bolt action used by every army, German, British, French, in the lead up to World War II. Unfortunately, in 1941, Nazi Germany invades the Soviet Union and unleash a horrendous campaign of genocide and violence against the Soviet people. The war in the East was not a war to end communism or a war to free people. It was a war to clear off land for German settlement. To that end, something as complex as the SVT-40 is not going to cut it. We need rifles quick to arm against an enemy that wants to destroy you and your people. So to that end, the SVT, while an amazing rifle that would be actually be copied by the Germans in their Gewehr 43, is not something that ever sees very wide issue, but a nice relic of that period all the same. I have over here also something that would have been carried hopefully by a lot of Soviet soldiers, and this is a tobacco bag. Something like this was not provided by the state. The state provided everything else, the uniform on your back, the weapons you would have used, and weapons that would have been available in quantity. The old myth of two men, one rifle is just that, a myth. But what the Soviet government couldn't provide was personal items, things that would make soldiers' lives easier. You had tobacco, but they were not provided rolling papers. You had, okay, tobacco, and you had nothing to put it in. So as a result, the Soviet government mobilizes its civilian population. Of course, it mobilizes them for war, it mobilizes them in industry, but also mobilizes its young citizens to create these pouches. And these are just simple drawstring bags with patriotic messages or messages of love embroidered upon them. School children would embroider with things like, kill the fascists and defend our country. Grim for a school child, I know, but this is total war. They would also be written by sweethearts at home, wives, daughters, even mothers, and they would put on here. So this translates to something like, may my love protect you. I don't know if you can see it. May my love protect you from bullets. Love, Sveta. And of course, patriotic logos, patriotic motifs were popular as well. Of course, simply a red star that was the symbol of the Soviet Union and of course of the Soviet people. Through the efforts of both the Red Army and the civilian population, which would be pushed to their limits in terms of being worked in factories or being drafted to die on the fields against Nazi Germany, the Soviet Union overcomes this. However, it does it at extreme cost. The Soviet Union would suffer about 27 million casualties during World War II, and of those 27 million, the overwhelming majority were of civilians, not soldiers dying in trenches or in tanks or in airplanes, but against innocent civilians who would be destroyed by the genocidal ambitions of Nazi Germany. However, the Soviet Union ends this war as a superpower, at great cost, unfortunately, but they would function as the decisive actor of World War II. They inflict the majority of casualties on the German army, and some historians also argue that their quick campaign against the Japanese in Manchuria in 1945 was as much of a reason for Japanese surrender as the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Whatever the cost, the Soviet Union would enter into a Cold War with the United States, collapsing in 1991. Some people argue from the effects of World War II, the demographic effects. So with that, that's a little bit further ahead. We hope you guys enjoyed this presentation. We are again the 50th Rifle Division as part of Military History Club Istochnik. We are a group that likes to promote a same standard across the board, a same high standard of both material conditions, of course, which we use reproductions and things like that, but also of historical knowledge. We tend to use more cutting-edge sources, less reliance on sources that were written at the height of the ideological Cold War. And this all culminates in, we hope, a slightly more educational experience than you'd get from most run-and-gun reenactments. Thank you, guys.